Okay, so I remind you that yesterday we arrived to a first, broad characterization of composite X scenario in terms of two sectors, which were the composite sector and the elementary one. Okay, and an interaction among the two. Okay, between the two. So I told you that the most important thing to study, I told you that the very important property of the composite sector is to have a global group G, which gets spontaneously broken at a certain confinement scale M star to a subgroup H. Okay, and that the Higgs is a pseudo-Nambu-Goldstone boson of this breaking. So the scale at which the breaking occurs, okay, does not necessarily coincide with the order parameter of the breaking. Okay? For instance, the scale at which the electroweak symmetry breaking occurs is the W mass, while the order parameter is the electroweak scale. Those are two completely different things. So, but they are related, okay? As we will see, up to one coupling. So just to avoid making confusion, let's call F, okay, the scale. The order parameter associated with the breaking, and M star is the scale where this occurs. Okay. So in the first part of the lecture, I want to start describing more quantitatively the composite sector, focusing on the infrared part, which is physics taking place at this M star, which is a very high energy. It's TV, but it's the infrared with respect to the very high energies we assume we are starting from in our theory. So I want to describe the physics, basically, of this spontaneous symmetry breakdown. And I want to explain how we can obtain, indeed, the Higgs boson as a Nambu-Goldstone boson by the mechanism of vacuum misalignment. Okay? So the thing is as follows. So there is a global group G, of the composite sector. It has a subgroup to which it will be broken, which is called H. And we are going to pick up G and H such that H is large enough to contain the full electroweak group. Okay? So this contains SU2 left cross U1 hypercharge, okay? And we will soon see an example of such a group, okay? To understand vacuum misalignment, you have to proceed as follows. So let's call T capital A the full set of generators of the Lie group G. And let's split them into two sets, as you typically do when you discuss spontaneous symmetry breakdown. The first set is called T little a, and the second is T at a at. Okay. The first set is a number of generators that put together, they are capable to generate the algebra of the subgroup H. And this one, we are going to call them the unbroken generators. While these other ones are the broken generators. The unbroken generators define the Lie algebra of H, while the broken, they are all what is left, we call them, they are those that define the coset space G over H. Okay? Okay. So, as you understand, the choice of the generator basis in a theory which is perfectly invariant is completely arbitrary. It's like a choice of a reference system. Okay? However, we know that this G symmetry is eventually going to be broken by several effects among which by the fact that we want to identify part of this, say, G generators inside H as the electroweak generators, okay? And we will gauge these generators by introducing the gauge fields. And this will make an explicit breaking of the symmetry, and so will give us a preferred reference frame. So in choosing what is called here unbroken and what is called broken, I will do it in the following way. So I will do in such a way that the electroweak generators, okay, so the ones of the SU2 left cross U1 hypercharge, are some linear combination only of the unbroken, okay, TA, okay, with no component on the ones that we called broken, okay? Okay. So basically, G electroweak, okay, belongs, okay, belongs, is inside H. Of course, all these are reversed, okay? Contains A and contains H. Okay. So, we can also define, given this basis of the generators, what we will call a reference vacuum. F. So our fields will be, our theory will have plenty of operators, among which there will be scalar operators, composite or elementary, doesn't matter, so those who can take a VEV, and this defines a representation of the group, and inside this, this space of field, we can take a special direction, F, which is defined such that TA applied to F is equal to zero, and TA at applied to F is different from zero, okay? So the reference vacuum is defined in such a way that if the true VEV of the field phi had to be parallel, had to coincide with F, okay? So if the true VEV is aligned with F, okay, then what happens is that F does not break really the what we call the unbroken generator. It breaks only the broken ones. And since the electroweak generators are part of these ones, or the unbroken ones, okay, the electroweak group is unbroken. So if the true VEV of the theory coincides with the reference vacuum, there is no electroweak symmetry breaking. Okay. Of course, it's not what's gonna happen. Okay, and the amount by which the true vacuum is not parallel to F is exactly the vacuum misalignment we are talking about. Okay, and it induces electroweak symmetry breaking. That's why here I said quote unquote unbroken and quote unquote broken, because actually this way of splitting the generators, okay, does not correspond to what the vacuum will decide to be. Okay, it's just a reference system which defines, which is defined through the reference vacuum. Okay? So, so the reference vacuum is useful also for another thing. So we can use the reference vacuum to parameterize the fluctuation of the physical fields that correspond to the massless Goldstone bosons, okay? So if I take the reference vacuum, which is one of the allied vacua of the theory, in the case in which there is no explicit breaking, they're all the same, and I act on it with an element of G along the, say, broken generators, I end up with something like this, e to the I theta A at T at A at, okay, where these theta, written here, are fields, which depends on X, and as you know from the general proof of the Goldstone theorem, those are massless fields, okay? They are massless fields because if I set them to constants, okay, the configuration I'm studying is actually equivalent to the vacuum up to a symmetry transformation, so it has the same energy, which means that constant thetas do not cost any energy. which means that constant theta, so the theta has no potential. It has no mass, it's a massless state, and what we call the Gorton boson. Similarly, well, so a priori, in a theory with a completely exact G-group, these theta fields have no mass, they have no potential, so they are flat direction, they can have any web, and so their web spans, all possible vacua which are obtained by F, okay, rotating. But then we should imagine that we are introducing explicit breaking, so there will be a potential for theta being generated, and so from this potential of theta, okay, you will get actually a definite value for the vacuum expectation value of theta A. And so you will be able to determine the true vacuum, web of phi equal to e to the I, web of theta A hat, t hat A hat f. Okay? And now you start seeing what happens. So if the web of the Gorsons happen to be zero, okay, so the true vacuum is aligned with F, okay? And then there is no electroweak symmetry breaking because the web is only breaking the generators which were orthogonal, which were not containing the electroweak group. The electroweak group was entirely inside these ones. But if theta takes a web which is different from zero, then you do break the electroweak symmetry, okay? So theta, defined in this way, behaves exactly like the X field of the standard model. If it takes a web, it breaks the symmetry. If it doesn't, it doesn't break the symmetry, okay? And so this parametrization is the simplest one to appreciate how a Gorston boson theta field can actually behave like the X, okay? We can draw a picture of this. So this vector is F, okay, and the norm of this vector is the order parameter for the G2H breaking, what we called before little f. And orthogonal to this direction, there is the plane of H transformation. So H is made of transformation which are orthogonal, which leaves invariant this F. And we say that inside H there is the electroweak group. So you can imagine the electroweak generators as, again, acting as transformation in this plane. And then this is the reference vacuum. It's not the true vacuum. The true vacuum is this one. It's a vector with the same norm, F, but with an angle. Okay, with respect to F, and this angle is set by web of theta. So let me be sloppy here and call web of theta now the modulus. Theta has different components, okay, has one component for each broken generator, let's say modulus of theta. Okay, so this measures the angle between this and that, so by trigonometric we can understand how much is broken the electroweak group. So again, if theta is zero, no breaking because I can freely rotate. If theta is a little bit misaligned, then all what matters for the breaking is the projection of the true vacuum on this plane, which makes an amount of breaking V. Okay, V is the is what we would like to be 246, which means the electroweak symmetry breaking order parameter, which is determined as V equal to F sine web of theta. Okay? So that's the generic story of vacuum misalignment. You do find a theory where the Gorston bosons behave like the Higgs, so their web triggers electroweak symmetry breaking. And the amount of electroweak symmetry breaking that you have, okay, is not fixed. So it's related with the amount of breaking F of the full G to H times a free parameter, which is the misalignment angle theta. Okay. This misalignment angle is also called defined in terms of another parameter, which is called xi. So let me introduce it for future use. Xi is v square over f square, and so it is just the sine square of bev theta. Okay, and you see it measures basically the square of the hierarchy that we can have in the theory between v 246 and f. Okay. Okay. So depending on what is xi, depending on whether v over f is larger or smaller, so is equal to 1 or is much smaller than 1, you get completely different, results and phenomenology. So if xi is close to 1, or let's say is just equal to 1, okay, what this means? It means that geometrically the true bev is pointing in a random direction with respect to f. So somehow it made no sense at all to define an f and to identify broken and unbroken in that way, because the bev is in a direction that breaks, if you want, at the same level both the a at and the electroweak generators, which are only with ta, right? So for xi equal to 1, the size of the breaking of the electroweak symmetry is just comparable with the size of the breaking of the extra generators, okay? So somehow it's like not having put at all the extra symmetries, okay? And indeed, this xi equal to 1 limit is called the technicolor. Limit. Because remember what was happening, if you know, in technicolor. In technicolor, you were having a theory which had a group G, okay, a global symmetry group G, which contained the electroweak group, but H, the subgroup, was too small. It was only the U1 electromagnetic. So the breaking G to H was directly breaking the electroweak symmetry, okay? There was no intermediate H. And here is happening just the same thing, because the bev is, after all, okay, aligned in a random way, okay, at 90 degrees, such that the bev is breaking the electroweak symmetry directly. Okay, so the xi equal to 1 limit is not interesting in composite theories because it's just adding more, say, complication to technicolor theories. And the case which is instead interesting is when xi is smaller than 1, or let's say much smaller than 1. So when there is a gap between v and f. So you can consider this in a limiting situation. So V has to be fixed because V is 246, is the one we need for the realistic electroweak symmetry breaking that we observed. But still, if xi is going to zero, so we can achieve xi going to zero by F going to infinity. Okay. So remember that I told you that F and M star are not the same thing. M star was the confinement scale, but they are related. So basically now, if I allow for xi to be very, very small, I can consider a limit in which I keep all the electroweak physics at the same place, while the confinement scale and F, they just grow and go to infinity, and so they eventually decouple, okay? So, and indeed, in the original paper by Jojai and Kaplan, this was an example to show how you could get the microscopic origin of the electroweak theory with xi, let's say, I don't know, 10 to the minus 5, far from what could be observed at that time and even today, by this decoupling limit, okay? By this decoupling limit. And so, given that there is this decoupling limit, we do expect that in this decoupling limit, all what is left in the theory is the Higgs boson, okay? With properties that must be similar to those of a renormalizable Lagrangian of any Higgs boson, okay? Because if you can generate a gap, it means that there is a range of energies in which you can live with the theory in which there is only the Higgs, plus, of course, the electroweak bosons and the fermions that we will introduce on top, and there is nothing else up to very high energy scales. And the only way for this big gap to be generated is if the theory that you have reduces to the standard model. You know very well that if you start modifying, tilting a little bit the standard model couplings, then you encounter, inconsistencies and the cutoff, which can be at low scale. So if you want to really reach this decoupling, you know that in between these two scales, there's going to be the standard model. Now, we are going to verify this in an example in a while, but please keep in mind that it is a generic expectation in all these scenarios that all the couplings of the Higgs, but not only, also the couplings of the electroweak bosons, so all the couplings in the electroweak and also in the fermion sector of composite Higgs particles, so particles with composite Higgs origin, are actually similar, are actually equal to those of the standard model, up to corrections of order xi. Okay? And this is what makes the advantage of composite Higgs with respect to Technicolor, because in Technicolor, xi is 1, so these corrections are really always of order 1, which means that you can measure, I don't know, the coupling of the Higgs to vector boson and find that it's 2 in the units where the standard model is 1. Okay? So this cannot occur in composite Higgs because there is this limit, okay, that you can take in which the new physics decouples and you're left only with the standard model. And that's always going to be the case in all models of composite Higgs. And again, now we're gonna do a very simple example to verify this. Please. You can show. Let me say this once again, because it's important. It's a bit complicated, but it's important. So when we speak about vacuum misalignment, we have to understand the misalignment with respect to what, okay? So one of the two things is the true bed. So that's a true vacuum, okay? And the other thing must be, well, must be a reference, okay? Must be a reference system. So, and the right reference system is this vacuum F. This vacuum F is nothing. It's simply the direction of the vacuum in which electroweak symmetry would not be broken, okay? Yeah, question was about the reference vacuum. The reference vacuum is like setting a reference system in the Lie algebra, okay? Only that if you do it in a complicated way, you get a very complicated, and yeah, there are papers where it's done in a different way, which makes things completely messy. Please.
Vector space, which we define the group, or?
This object, which object?
F.
Oh, so F is, like in the general theory of spontaneously broken symmetries. So imagine you have all your fields, all your theory, okay? In particular, you need the bosonic ones, because they are only those that can take a BEV in a Lorentz invariant way, okay? Well, in a logical way, okay. Only those which you can take a BEV. And this will form a big multiplet, okay? You can, as big as you like, irreducible representation, doesn't matter, okay? All this is all algebra. And this is one possible configuration in that field space. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. So this, I hope this is clear, but I'm sure it will become even more clear with the example that that follows. But sorry, before this, so it's important you understand clearly what we are doing. So we have found, okay, a unique parameter, psi, that is capable to control all the possible deviations of the predictions that will come in a composite Higgs theory with respect to the standard model, okay? Actually, I should be more precise because you may define composite Higgs theories which contain more than one Higgs doublet. For instance, you can do the composite 2x doublet model or a doublet plus a scalar. So in this case, of course, the coupling will not just go to the standard model, but they will go to the renormalizable, to the corresponding renormalizable weakly coupled theory of 2x doublet model or of extra singlets or whatever you want. There is a question? You're asking what I need the group G for. Obviously, if it was not for the presence of the group G, there would not be any, say, broken generators, okay? And so any Goldstone boson to talk about.
But in the end, you break generators at H, no? In the
picture, I break them by the BEV of the Goldstone bosons which live in the coset G over H. And also, if you want, these generators here, which is the fact that these guys are Goldstones, is essential to make the Higgs light. This is what I say in the first lecture. If I don't have this part, there is no protection. Okay, there is no protection for the Higgs mass. Okay. Again, the important thing. The important thing was that. It's true. Okay, I have this parameter, and for a model builder used to a zillion of constraints from all possible places that can invalidate your theory. Having one such a parameter is great. Okay, because you know that you can systematically recover the standard model. On the other hand, it's obvious that when you do this, it's clear that you are hiding your extra physics, right? So. Differently from the original, ideological, very good paper by Georgi and Kaplan, here we don't want psi to be 10 to the minus 3 or 10 to the minus 5, okay? Because we believe, even though there is not conclusive evidence of this, that in the models we do have, setting psi small is, okay, a fine-tuning. So in principle, psi, is defined by the sine square of a web of something. This something can go on the whole circle. So you imagine that this sine goes from 0 to 1. So in average, it will be 1/2, OK? Well, 1 over whatever, OK? So if I want instead the psi of the order of 0.1, which as of now is what we think we need, 0.1 or 0.2, then I have to accept that something strange has happened by an amount which we can call fine-tuning, which has to occur in some place. In which place? In the X potential, because psi is fixed by the web of theta, which in turn is fixed by this potential that we will generate. It will have three parameters which we will be able to adjust in such a way to make that theta as small as we like, but this will cause a certain amount of fine-tuning. So, and there are no models in which the fine-tuning is less than 1 over xi. So given xi, you can quantify how much tuning you are doing in this theory. On the other hand, it's true that model building is full of there's plenty of possibilities, perhaps in model building, that we have not yet explored. So if the Higgs potential has some particular peculiar structure because of symmetry of selection rules, for instance, such that it has a mass term which is parametrically smaller than the quartic, you may try to naturally accommodate a small xi. But as far as I know, there is no working example of this. So for the time being, when you say xi equal to 0.1, you have to imagine of making a tuning of at least 10. Questions? you were the first.
Does that mean we can never rule out technicolor by experiment?
It's not technical.
Sorry. Composite Higgs, I meant.
No. The same, very same way you can never rule out supersymmetry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the psi doesn't have any implications for... The only implication it has is there is some fine-tuning involved. And if we accept there is fine-tuning, composite Higgs will always survive.
You can go on your whole life.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Sorry, I just don't understand how you define this field in terms of the vacuum, but then the other term is just broken, like the Gaussian boson belongs to the broken parameter. I don't get how.
Let's say, let me try. Well, the simplest example is when you have the theory we're going to show in a second, a theory of scalars, a theory of scalar fields, okay? A scalar multiplet in certain representation of this G group, okay? Now, this has a family of vacua. The vacuum of this is not only one, because the G symmetry is, as long as the G symmetry is an exact symmetry, okay, you can always act on the vacuum with the rotation on the group, and you will get the same energy. So you will get another vacuum, okay? So when we, so if you now try to, if you want, if you are interested in the lowest mass fluctuation of this field phi, okay, you can parameterize them in this way. So you take one of the reference, any of the possible vacua, and you act on them with a symmetry transformation. If you do a symmetry transformation on the H generators, nothing changes because this F was invariant under the symmetry transformation. Okay? If you act with the broken generators, you do have a non-trivial, a different field configuration, which is the one that the Goldstones populate when they are turned on. So it's the answers, if you want, for the Goldstone fields. Okay? There's a question there?
Yeah. So I was trying to draw an analogy with what happens in the standard model. So in the standard model, the vacuum expectation value can be always chosen to be in the real direction by the kind of the residual symmetry. I mean, yeah. So if you say that this G breaks to H, and then this vacuum has this symmetry, this pi goes to exponential something times F, can't we use that symmetry to always align the wave direction with F? I mean, in that case, the Gi will not be a physical parameter.
So, exactly. So, if the symmetry is completely unbroken, so if G is exact, then two things happen. One, when I said that H, that the Goldstone have no potential, so there is no preference value for this vev of theta, okay? And second, that this vev of theta is unphysical. Okay?
Yeah, right.
Exactly because what you say, because you can always reabsorb the web of theta by the definition inside phi.
Yeah.
Okay? So the only reason why theta instead gets a potential and gets physical is because there is the explicit breaking. Okay?
Okay. Okay, I mean.
If you want, if I don't know where to project here, okay? So here I get electroweak symmetry breaking because I know I'm projecting on this plane. And why exactly on this plane? Because this is the plane where there is the electroweak group, not in this other plane.
No. So I understand that this B breaks the electroweak symmetry, but my question is that can't we make always that angle zero by using that symmetry?
If it is not an exact symmetry, okay?
So
when you do this operation, you will reintroduce theta somewhere else.
Okay, so you are introducing an explicit breaking term for the G in the potential.
The explicit breaking is the fact that we identify part of this generator with the electroweak generators. So in concrete, the fact that we gauge the W and the Z boson.
Okay.
Okay. I will show you one billion example in 1 second. Okay.
Okay. Okay. That will help me.
In this example, there will be 3 generators. One will be gauged, and this breaks the symmetry. Okay. Can you still hear me? The microphone looks no. Okay, now I tell you the example. If no, doesn't work. Okay. So if you will still have question after this example, you can please ask me, okay? So the example is the simplest possible Higgs model, which is the abelian. Okay? Abelian, of course, composite Higgs model. So, I will show you now how to construct a model, I mean, like similar to the usual U1X model that that you study in all textbooks, okay? So this is done by taking an SO3 global symmetry group, okay? And imagining having a system that breaks this spontaneously to SO2, okay? SO2 is just U1, so this U1 is gonna be the U1 gauge symmetry of the billion X model. So you can do this in the simplest possible way, okay, by a representative version of the composite sector. It's not a good representative, okay? It's just one example theory that does like this. The theory of a real triplet of fields, which transform under SO3 as a triplet, so phi goes to G5, okay, where G belongs to SO3. Okay. Next, you will write down the simplest possible Lagrangian for this field, and you will regard this Lagrangian as a representative Lagrangian for how, say, the composite sector could look like. Again, it's very different from a strongly interacting complicated theory. It's just an example. So you will have a kinetic term, d mu phi transpose d mu phi, and then you will have minus some potential, g star square over 8 phi transpose phi minus f square square. Okay? So, sorry? Well, come on, I will use it only once. And by the way, this is called G star, okay? This is called G star. And G star, okay, now I'll tell you what G star means. So, the vacua, okay, in this tree space, so now you see what is the space defined of. Okay, the space of the field phi was a general thing in the previous part, and now it's just three fields, okay, three real fields, so the space is R3. And inside this space of field configuration, there is the family of the vacua, which is just the two sphere, okay? Because the minimizing this potential leads to a family of vacua characterized by the web of phi modulus equal to F. And, see? So, G star square over 8 for a normalization. Okay? And here there is phi transpose phi minus F square. I will, now I have to choose the representative vacuum. Okay? Let me choose it in the following way. So, I work in a field basis where F is just 0, 0, F. Okay? So associated with this reference vacuum, there is the choice of the generators, which are like this. So I will take one generator, which is unbroken, and it's called T, and is 1 over root square of 2. And it's block diagonal, so there is sigma 2, 0, 0, 0. Okay, it's a 3x3 matrix. And then there are two broken generators. The first one is T at 1, which is 1 over root square of 2. Square of 2. So the rotation in the other direction, right? This is the rotation in the 1, 2 direction, and this one, for instance, 0, 0, minus I, 0, 0, 0, I, 0, 0, is the rotation in the 1, 3 direction. And then similarly, I will have a T at 2, okay? T at 2, which will look exactly the same, just that minus I goes down here and I goes here, okay? Okay, so as you know from the Goldstone theorem, by counting the number of broken generators, which are these two, I can find how many Goldstone bosons I have. I have two Goldstone bosons, two real Goldstone bosons, okay? Which combined together will make one complex field. And this one complex field is gonna be the complex X field of the abelian X model. So to study this theory and to see exactly where the Higgs comes from, you have studied, I mean, you should know that a very convenient way to proceed is to change field basis. So rather than using phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3, the components of phi, it's better to go to the nonlinear basis, in which phi is described as follows. So you start from a reference configuration, which is 0, 0, f plus sigma of x, okay? And you apply to this a rotation. So you apply to this e to the I square root of 2 over f pi I of x t at I, okay? So what is this? So this is exactly what I wrote in the previous slide. So if I set sigma to 0, okay, here I just have the representative vacuum on which I act with a broken symmetry transformation. And this allows me to describe 2 degrees of freedom of the 3 that I had inside phi, okay, which basically correspond in the 3 space. This is the angle I form with respect to this vector 0, 0, 1, okay? So I move in this way. And then there is sigma, which controls the norm of the vector, okay? It's the radial mode. And that's not going to be a Goldstone boson. So here I already see that sigma is going to be a massive particle that, given that I'm interested in, say, describing something that looks like a composite sector, I will call it a resonance. Okay? While these ones are the Goldstone bosons, and they're going to be massless. So the Nambu Goldstone bosons. Okay. So you can really work out this exponential explicitly. Okay, it's just a bit complicated matrix. I'm not gonna write it down. Instead, I will write down. Starting from that Lagrangian, you can use this nonlinear basis, and you can describe, of course, exactly the same physics in terms of the variables, which are sigma and pi. And the Lagrangian becomes like this. I want to write it once to illustrate a couple of things. So there's going to be 1 half d sigma square minus g star f square over 2 sigma square. So I'm going to get a kinetic term and a mass term for sigma. And take note of this formula. That's going to be useful in what follows. The mass of the sigma, which is a resonance, so sigma has a mass which I expect to be of the order of the confinement scale, so let me call m sigma equal to m star. This mass is given by g star f. Okay? So it's different from zero, can be arbitrarily heavy if f is large or if g star is very large coupling. Okay? But then there are some interactions, like for instance g star square f. I will use this interaction at a certain point, so just take notes for the moment. Sigma cube minus g star square over 8 sigma to the fourth. Okay? And then I have a rather complicated Lagrangian, which involves sigma and the Goldstones, which is like this. There is 1 half. There is 1 plus sigma over f square. And then we get, again, this structure here. So f square over pi square. Pi is the norm of the pi vector, no? There are 2 pi's, so pi is the square root of pi square. So this is pi square. Sine square pi over f d pi modulus square. There is other complicated terms like f square over 4 pi to the fourth pi square over f square minus sine square pi over f d, so the derivative of pi square itself, everything square. Okay. So let's note a couple of simple things about this Lagrangian. First of all, if you expand it around pi equal to 0, you find that it has no singularity, as it has to have, in spite of having 1 over pi in all places. So it just gives a kinetic term for pi. It gives no mass term for pi, obviously, because we know in general that this is an Nambu-Goldstone boson, so it has no mass. and it gives a number of interactions. And also notice one thing, that all these complicated polynomial and nonlinear functions of pi are actually always controlled by the ratio pi over f. Okay? So the Gorsons appear in the Lagrangian basically as pi over f, up to an overall multiplicative factor. And this happens because the Gorsons appear through this matrix here, okay, which is which has been written as pi over f. And the reason why I've written it as pi over f is because I want pi to be canonically normalized. Okay? In the previous example, I was calling, if you want, all this exponent to be theta, was a dimensionless field, and now I want a dimension one scalar field, and so I normalize it by f. Okay? Just one word of notation. This exponential, so e to the I square root of 2 pi e t at I, is called the Gorson matrix, and it's denoted as u of pi. Okay? And you see explicitly it depends only on pi over f. Okay. Please. There is an f squared to pi to the fourth. Yes, because you see there is an f squared which comes from the prefactor. Okay? So the Lagrangian is a... Si.
I'm not sure I understand what are you doing. So you have an SO3 group and you have a field in it, and will I be right in saying, like, you have two directions of vacuum expectation value and something like fixed angle between them and these sigmas?
No, you see, the vacuum is a sphere because it's controlled by, it's a two-sphere. Just the norm of phi is fixed. So the space of the sphere has two coordinates, which are the pi, okay? And then there is one radial mode, okay? The radial mode is sigma.
Yeah, so you have one direction where you have non-zero vacuum expectation value, and then you express this in...
Then I simply, I mean, this is just a field redefinition, okay?
Okay, yeah.
This is a field redefinition. It's a complicated field redefinition that is needed to illustrate a couple of things, okay?
Yes, and this vacuum misalignment when you get this angle between one field...
The vacuum misalignment here, you will see it in a second explicitly, it will have to do, of course, with the web of pi, okay? When pi gets a web, web of pi equal to f if is the reference vacuum, and if web of pi is different from zero, then the web doesn't point direct along f, but it's a little bit tilted, okay? So web of pi is the misalignment angle.
So at the end, you can break SO3 to SO2 and then to U1, something like that.
No, SO2 is U1. Okay?
Well, yeah.
So at the end of everything, I will have broken everything. Because exactly I want to build the U1X model in which the U1 is broken.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay.
No, here I'm writing just 2 pi 1 and pi 2,
no,
two real fields.
Sine of pi.
Oh, this is pi square. This is sine of square, so this is the norm of pi. Square root, so it's square root of pi 1 2 plus pi 2 square, pi 1 square plus pi. Yeah, it's the modulus. Okay? Okay, so a couple of messages which come from this Lagrangian. So one is that the Gorsons are massless. The second is that the Gorson interaction are all up to a proportionality factor of f squared controlled by pi over f. There is pi over f in all places. And the other message is that the Gorson-Lagrangian appears very complicated, nonlinear, okay? And it's clear that all these nonlinearities will eventually trigger new physics effect in the X-Capix, and this is what we are going to compute in a second, okay? What is less trivial when you look at this Lagrangian is that this Lagrangian is complicated, but it's extremely symmetric Lagrangian, okay? It has a number of symmetries, and basically three symmetries that correspond to each of the three SO3 generators we started from. Because this Lagrangian, as I told you, is just a rewriting in a different coordinate for the fields of the original Lagrangian that had this symmetry, okay, with a poorly chosen name G for the transformation. Okay? So all these Gs will have something, some effect also here. And the reason why the Lagrangian is so complicated and it's difficult to identify all these symmetries is that the symmetries now act on pi in a complicated called non-linear way. So are non-linearly realized on pi. Okay. It works like this. So we wrote phi. Look at phi. Phi is a Gorson matrix, which is this exponential of matrices pi, which depends on the Gorsons, applied to f plus 0, 0, f plus sigma. Okay? So suppose operating on pi with the following transformation. So take pi, send it to pi of g. G is an element of S of 3. Okay? So this map defines the representation. So the rule to change pi, okay, into something else, depending on what is G is. So this is a representation of the SO3 group that is defined implicitly in the following way. So it is such that U of pi G, okay, is equal to G dot U. This is matrix multiplication. U, you see, is just a 3x3 matrix like G. U dot pi times h to the minus 1. So this h to the minus 1 is another matrix. It depends on pi and on g. And the important property of this h matrix is that it is not a full SO3 matrix, but it's just a matrix that lives in the SO2. Okay? So h belongs to SO2. Or if you want to see this explicitly, H is a block diagonal matrix made of here some letter H, which is basically the exponential, okay, e to the I some psi sigma 2, right? Sigma 2 is the rotation of the 2 by 2. And here is 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay? It is possible to show that so this is non-trivial. So it's non-trivial that I can find an action, so I can find a rule to change pi into pi g such that the Gorson matrix changes into this way. Okay? But it's true for any at least compact Lie groups G and H. And by the way, is the starting point for a very brilliant construction called Kallan-Coleman Bessen-Zumino construction of nonlinearized symmetries. Okay? So this thing exists. So if this operation exists, then I can act on this, I can act with this operation on phi, and look what I find. I find phi that goes into u of pi g phi, which is just g u of pi times h to the minus 1 applied to 0, 0, f plus sigma. Okay? But this one has zeros in the first two components, so it doesn't care of an SO2 rotation, and so H is like it was never there. Okay. And then the result of this transformation on pi, while leaving sigma invariant, you see sigma, I'm leaving it the same, it just means that phi goes to G dot phi. So it is a symmetry transformation. Okay? It is just one of the SO3 symmetry transformation. Okay? So it exists this complicated rule that, that allow us to change pi leaving the Lagrangian invariant, so it's a perfect symmetry of the Lagrangian. Okay? And actually it turns out that this Lagrangian here is the most general possible two-derivative Lagrangian. Here there are two derivatives here, also here. Okay? that you can write compatibly with these complicated non-linearized symmetries. Okay. There are cases in which this transformation actually becomes very simple. So if I consider a transformation, an element G, okay, inside of taking a generic one in SO3, let me take G equal to GH, which only belongs to the SO2 subgroup. Okay? So in this case, you can show that actually the H matrix is just GH itself. Okay? So in this case, you can work this out explicitly and find that the transformation you need is only a rotation. So pi that goes to pi as a doublet that goes like e to the I, some say zeta sigma to pi. Okay? This is the way in which the Gorsons transform under the Broglie transformation. The general rule is the following. You take the adjoint of SO3, which is a 3, and you see that it decomposes into a 1 under the SO2 group plus another representation, which is the doublet of SO2, okay? And if you look at this other representation, is how the Gorson transform, okay? So that's a general result from the Gorson theorem. If you have the adjoint of G, you decompose it into H, you find necessarily the adjoint of H plus something else. This something else is how the Gorsons transform, okay? And in this case, they just form a doublet of SO2. And this you can verify immediately that the Lagrangian is invariant. It's all function of d pi square, there is never something that breaks it, so this is trivially a symmetry of the Lagrangian. It's a bit more complicated, the case in which the transformation do not belong to H. I can work it out at the infinitesimal level for you. So if G is like the identity plus I, so let's make a transformation along the Broglie generators. Alpha I hat T hat, oh, so I, T hat I. Okay, so these are two transformation parameters associated to the Broglie generator 1 and to the Broglie generator 2. I can write for you the full formula, which is that pi, this transformation, pi to pi g, becomes pi that goes to pi plus. So that's the modulus of pi, cotangent pi over f, alpha plus f over pi minus cotangent pi over f. And then there is alpha scalar pi and then pi over pi. Okay? So if you are bold enough, you can take this this operation, do it on the Lagrangian, and check that it's indeed invariant. Okay? Even if, of course, at first sight, you will not have said. And this is this transformation that constrains the form of that Lagrangian to be like that, to be unique. It's interesting also to look at this formula in the small pi field limit, okay? Because this becomes pi plus, if you expand pi cotangent alpha, you get f alpha plus higher orders in pi square. So if you are at low pi, you can view this transformation just as a shift of pi. See? Yeah, it's a bit strange. It's f over pi. I can put online this notes, however, if you like. Okay. So that's something you may have heard about. This pi goes to pi plus something, which is proportional to the transformation parameter. That's the shift symmetry. Okay? And in particular, the shift symmetry is what guarantees that pi cannot have any mass and any potential and nothing else, because a non-derivative term will never survive, okay, becoming invariant under this transformation. Okay? So that's the basic of the formalism of non-linearly realized symmetries that we are going to use in the next lecture. Okay. Now I want to complete the construction of the abelian composite X theory. So now we want to introduce the gauge fields. Okay. So we need the U1 gauge field. And so we have to choose one of these three generators to be identified with our U1 gauge symmetry. Given the way in which we parameterize the generators, we have already decided, actually, that the generator of the U1, which is going to be made local, okay, is the unbroken one, so it's T, right? The one that was rotating 1 into 2. Okay. And then I can change my Lagrangian into the final result by just coupling this, by just introducing a gauge field and coupling it to this generator. So I just promote d mu phi to a covariant derivative, which becomes capital D mu phi equal d mu minus I square root of 2, some electric charge, which will be the coupling of this gauge field, which I'm introducing now, square root of 2 normalization, A mu T coupled to phi. Okay? Okay, so now the system becomes a triplet, okay, coupled to a U1 gauge field that gauges only one of these three SO3 generators. So it's clear that this theory now doesn't have anymore an exact G symmetry. Okay. So you could immediately guess how this Lagrangian becomes. It will basically gain covariant derivatives in many places. To make things even more familiar with respect to the usual Abelian X model, I can also switch to complex notation, in which a complex X doublet is defined by the two components of pi 1 minus I pi 2 over square root of 2. Okay. So pi 1 and pi 2, they rotate with each other, which means that H gets a phase under the U1 transformation, so it just transforms like you expect for the normal X doublet. Then I can complete the exercise by writing down the Lagrangian I get for this object. So the Lagrangian for the Higgs. Now I'm setting the sigma resonance to 0. You could reintroduce it in a second, given the previous formula. So it's just the same as before, only in the complex notation. So f square over 2 modulus of h square sine square square root of 2 web of h over f d mu h modulus square. Okay? So that's basically a more complicated version of the usual d mu h square that you find, that you write down in a normalizable X model Lagrangian. The main difference is that rather than having 1 here, I have this sine square over h square, which, however, as you see, for h small, just becomes 1. Another term, which is f square over 8 modulus of h to the fourth, then there is 2 h modulus square over f square. And then there is some other trigonometric function, okay? So like minus sine of 2 square root of 2 modulus of h over f d mu h modulus square, okay? The covariant derivative here, so actually this is not covariant derivative because it's the derivative of h modulus square, which is a singlet, so you don't need to put any covariant derivative. And that's just the ordinary, right, d mu of the Higgs, the d mu of the Higgs, d mu minus I, E, A mu, H. Okay? So let's now to verify here a couple of things I told you. So first of all, trying to expand for f going to infinity. If you try to expand this Lagrangian for f going to infinity, you immediately realize that you just end up with the ordinary renormalizable Abelian X model Lagrangian. So dh square. Okay? And the reason is obvious because I told you that the Higgs can only enter up to a multiplicative factor as h over f. So if I start sending f to infinity, all the complicated nonlinearities, they just drop, and I'm left only with the leading term, which are those with less power of the x, so are just those which correspond to d equal 4 operators. And there is only one d equal 4 operator I can write in this theory compatible with gauge invariant, is this one. So I must end up here for f going to infinity. And so at the leading order in f going to infinity, which means psi going to exactly 0, that just recovers the standard model automatically. I don't have to do anything. Then the corrections that will induce, okay, if this was a true theory of electroweak symmetry breaking, they would induce, for instance, X coupling modifications, are terms like, I don't know, H modulus square over F square, DH square, okay? Plus many others, but all these are two derivatives, okay? Two derivatives acting on H, and then any power of H over F correction, okay? That's a class of operator which is under study at the LHC and for future collider. Now we will, well, next time probably, okay. We will say more about this. So first thing, for f going to infinity, okay, I get the renormalizable, okay, abelian Higgs model. Or if you want, I get an elementary Higgs model. The composite X tends to become elementary. It's Lagrangian coincides. The other interesting thing which I can notice, so the other important thing which I can have to do is to show you how indeed the electroweak symmetry is broken, assuming, of course, that this H will have developed a potential, okay, by the fact that the symmetry is broken. Okay, we will not discuss right now the potential generation, but H has a potential, so it will take a BEV. And then the first thing we can do is to go to the unitary gauge, where the Higgs is taken on the real direction, so V plus H over square root of 2. Okay. And here, somebody who asked before the question about whether I can redefine away V. You can do this, so try to set to zero the gauge coupling, okay, which appears in the covariant derivatives, okay, and you will discover that indeed V has no effect, okay? Why? Because the only way in which V can have an effect is because there is an explicit breaking of the symmetry, which is coming here, which is coming from the gauging, which is coming from the fact that I've gauged only one of the three generators, and this has broken the global symmetry, and so the X is not anymore an exact Goldstone boson. And you do see this only, also from the result. Let's just go to the unitary gauge and write the Lagrangian. Becomes incredibly simple. 1/2 dH squared, kinetic term for the Higgs, plus E square F square over 2 sine square V plus H over F A mu. Okay? You see the only place where the V remains, otherwise it's just the free Lagrangian, okay? Masser's free Lagrangian, is where there is the gauging. Okay? And the formula I think it's remarkably simple, and it's remarkably similar to the one that you will get in the usual Abelian X model. In the usual Abelian X model, just rather than F square sine, this is sine square, obviously, sine square V plus H over F, you would have got, instead of all this thing here, just V plus H square. That's the only difference. You replace V plus H square with this little bit more complicated trigonometrical function. Okay. So, I want now to read the various species that appear here, like the W boson mass term and the interaction, okay? So obviously, I hope the notation was clear. V here denotes the BEV of the Goldstone boson Higgs. Little h is the physical fluctuation, okay? So if I start Taylor expanding for small h, well, in series of h, I get no h interact term, which is a mass term, and I start getting interactions. Let's start from the mass term. So the mass of this field A, which I get after the composite X has taken a BEV, is E F sine V over F. So you see the usual story. It's like I anticipated. So let's call this E times V, right? So in the abelian, ordinary abelian composite X, you define, so the VEV of the X is just the MA over E, okay? So just to make the analogy, let's call V all what multiplies F, and so V is F sine V over F. So V over F is the misalignment angle, right? Because it's what was entering in the exponent of the Goldstone matrix. Before there was not this F normalization, there was just theta. But you see that it's the same formula as before, V equal to F sine of the misalignment angle. So Xi, right? The important parameter before, V square over F square, is as it has to be, is sine square V over F, okay? So I have this parameter I can use to control V, which up to a constant, which is the coupling constant, gives the mass of A. So I can keep, for instance, V finite while sending F to infinity and go to this limit, right? To the F to infinity limit. And so I can systematically recover the standard model. And this we can see also, so the standard model, the elementary Higgs model. And this we can see also by computing explicitly out of this Lagrangian the couplings of the Higgs. That's just some trigonometry. So I go here, I expand the mass term in powers of H, and I find 1/2 ma square a square. Then there is, okay, 1, because we normalized everything to have the correct, let's say, mass for this gauge field. We absorbed the prefactor inside this. Then you expand, you get sine squared, you get sine, cosine, and then you have to use some trigonometric relation to re-express these signs in terms of xi. So you have, at the first order in H, you have 2, 1, minus xi, H, okay, over B. You can check this. And this is corresponds to an interaction involving one X field and two gauge fields. Then there is 1 minus 2 xi, h square over b square, minus 4/3, xi square root of 1 minus xi, h cube over b cube. And of course, I can continue, okay? And all these terms correspond to interaction with two gauge fields with an increasing number of powers, number of x legs. So the first such two such interactions are present also in the elementary X case, where that thing is just V plus H square, so you get up to H square. And but of course the coefficient is different. Okay? So look at what we find. So the composite X vertex of the Higgs and two gauge fields. So it's given by this 2H over V, which just reproduces the one you find for the ordinary, the normalizable elementary Higgs theory. Okay, so I factor out 2H, and there is only a multiplicative factor, square root of 1 minus xi. Okay, of course it goes to 1 when xi goes to 0. All the zillion of arguments, right? The normalizability, F going to infinity, Bayesian misalignment. You see, you verify this explicitly here. There is also the 2x, two vector boson vertices, which is the elementary result. Okay, elementary x result multiplied by another factor, which I can always 1 minus 2 xi, okay, controlled by the same parameter. There are also new interactions. So this interaction, for instance, in the case of the physical X, has been measured already. And at a certain point I will show you how much correction we can tolerate. This one has not been measured yet for the standard model, okay? And will probably not be measured at the LHC. But ideally, there are also, all these correlations, also the correlation between the change of this and that is predicted and is testable in the model. Then there are also higher order interactions, more Higgses and two gauge fields. okay, which are absent in the elementary case. And indeed, you see that once you normalize them properly with the scale V that corresponds to the physics of the Higgs, you see that they scale like psi. So they are proportional to psi, and so they go to zero. They become weak, okay, when psi goes to zero. Okay. So I think I'm supposed to stop here, and tomorrow we will briefly illustrate the minimal potentially realistic model of composite Higgs with the full breaking of SU2 broken to U1, but there will be no need of any other calculation because actually the result and the form of the Lagrangian that we will get are exactly already written at this blackboard. So I can already anticipate you that the coupling of the Higgs to vector boson will be modified by this amount. And next, we will start working hard to arrive on time at the end of the lecture to compute not only the Higgs coupling to vectors, which cannot be measured alone at the LHC, okay, they come together with the coupling to fermions, and so we will need also a prediction of the coupling to fermions, okay, to make the thing more more interesting. Okay. There's a question over there. Oh, the mass term. Oh, the question was where is the mass term of the Higgs? The mass term of the Higgs will come from the Higgs potential. Okay? So it is an effect that, as you see, is not present in this Lagrangian. Okay? Where it comes from? It comes at the radiative level. Hmm? Because when I gauge the U1, it's true that I break the symmetry, but I don't break it directly by introducing a mass term. I break it, so to introduce a mass term, I have to do some things like this. So for instance, this coupling, okay, of the Higgs with the gauge field, okay, will be capable to generate, so this one, for instance, okay, this one, will be capable to generate a mass term, okay? But it comes only at loop level by taking loops of the gauge fields itself, of the gauge field itself. Okay?
So your explicit symmetry breaking parameter is E.
Yeah.
So the mass term basically by E or even E squared.
The loop will have to contain, yes, the potential and the mass will be generated by loops of the gauge field, and so they will be proportional to E. E squared over 16 pi squared.
So how can you arrange this value to be well, the value of today, if the only free parameter for the mass is E, and
okay. So the full story. Well, first of all, you it's not so far. So if you we should do a more complete model, introduce many other things because the estimate of the size of the Higgs depends on several parameters. Okay. So I wish I could get there, but given the speed I go to, probably I will not. But a priori, there is no problem. And actually, The value of the Higgs mass, which is predicted by Higgs loops, so wait a second, the Higgs potential is not fully predicted, okay? Because you should know the full theory, and this loop is not a loop that you can compute, okay? You have to specify the full theory. But if you estimate it up to order one coefficient, the value of the Higgs mass that you get from the gauge loops is actually not far from 125, okay? What is a bit problematic and requires a certain gymnastic is to take care of the loop of the top that also contribute to that. And that tend to give a too heavy Higgs, okay?
But if you get the exact correct mass for the Higgs, it would be a very strong confirmation that the mix is indeed
composite,
right?
I told you, to get the exact correct mass, I have to build a UV theory, okay? A UV realization of all this with all the constituents. Then I have to go to a lattice friend and ask him to compute all possible correlators which I need. And then in 40 years, in 50 years, perhaps okay, this will be a strong confirmation. But it's model dependent, it's exact science, okay? And this is also why I will not spend so much on the X mass, because instead the X coupling modification are not model dependent. Okay? Your lattice friend will find what I'm saying independently of what are the details, okay, of the composite circuit.
So presumably the Higgs has been seen at the LHC, and they can constrain this Xi parameter.
Yeah.
Right. So what is the constraint as it stands, and does that directly already constrain the scale of the composite Higgs?
The constraint, there are two kinds of constraints. There is the constraint coming from the coupling measurement that, as you see here, basically constrains only Xi. And so the constraints F, okay? The parameter F. And this constraint corresponds to Xi, which is of the order of 0.2 or 0.1 if you take ATLAS or CMS, because ATLAS is more moved in the bad direction for composite Higgs. The sensitivity, the expected sensitivity is 0.2, so more or less you can say 0.1 if you take the Atlas stick. Okay? The other constraints on this Xi come from electroweak precision test in an indirect way. I already mentioned this, so these couplings of the Higgs are modified, and so this will show up in the loops that do electroweak precision test physics is sensitive to. Yeah, and then there are the constraints of the LHC instead of the rest of the scale of the on the on the partners. Oh, sorry, on the resonances. Okay.
And just additionally, so this Xi is also to be related to like some fine tuning measure.
Yes.
As well. Okay.
Yes, this is regarded to be a measure of how much fine tuning the theory is. But if I'm not sure we have tried to play enough with the potential. Of the Higgs, with the structure of the potential of the Higgs, to be completely sure that there couldn't be some structural reason why Xi is small. For instance, the little Higgs models, in the end, boil down to particular realization of composite Higgs, in which you do have a reason to have, a quartic which is larger than the mass term in this effective potential for the Higgs. And so you can naturally have, but they then tend not to work or to have other problems. But ideally, okay, it's not impossible.
Sorry, how do the triplan quartic Higgs couplings modify here? I mean, the vertex with three Higgses or four Higgses as in the standard model.
Yeah, so this depends on, this is part of the potential, obviously, no? So there is not a unique prediction before you tell me the details of this potential. So for instance, if you assume that the potential only comes from gauge fields, I can predict the form, the functional form of the potential, like it will be sine squared plus sine to the fourth, with two parameters. Okay, so if I set the BEV and the Higgs mass by these two parameters that your lattice guy had still had to compute, then I can predict, for instance, the trilinear Higgs coupling and the quartic. Actually, you know that most of the contribution to the Higgs mass will most likely come from the top sector. So if you specify the top sector. Some details of the top sector, I will tell you tomorrow which details, you can predict also that contribution. Okay, you can give a so there are special cases in which the functional form of the Higgs potential is so constrained that you can predict also the trilinear and the quartic. But there are also more general models in which the functional form is more complicated, you don't have only two parameters, and so the trilinear is still a free parameter.
It's model dependent, let's say.
In general, it's model dependent.
Thank you.
So I don't understand these couplings. That operator that you have there is the mu h squared and then squared.
Sorry.
These couplings here, I don't because I understand that. But so in that line there, the first line there in your Lagrangian for the h, you have the last operator that you have is the mu h squared and then squared.
Yeah, do the calculation. Yeah.
Yeah. Thing you use equations for motion for h and it modifies that. At the same effective dimension, I guess. So the mu h squared.
So the whole mass term only comes from here, okay? Because here there are no gauge fields. This is the derivative of a singlet.
You can use equations for motion in that.
Use whatever you want. Just plug this here.
That modifies that result.
So to find that result, you just have to pick this piece.
Right.
This one conspires with the other to give what your friend was asking. So to give the fact that the kinetic term of the x does not depend on b, as it doesn't have to, because it doesn't depend on E, so there is no breaking of the symmetry, and so here it must be like this. But this accounts when you sum this and that. For reading this result, that result is just a...
Yeah, you know, it's only the first part, but yeah. that's what I don't understand, because yeah, you can always use equations of motion there, and that will modify your couplings.
But you want to use the equation of motion. If you use the equation of motion properly, the coupling should not be modified.
Yeah, they are.
But, then you are not using the equation of motion properly.
Oh, I am. I mean,
no, because it depends what you do. You can move, of course, you can move. You can move.
I could be the
quark. Let's see what you can do. Of course, you can move things around, no? For instance, you can change the kinetic term, okay? If you do change the kinetic term, then you can write the couplings in a different way. But of course, the X is not, and that's not anymore the trivial kinetic term. So that's probably what you are doing. But you can show me the change.
We can take a look at it.
That is something I didn't get completely. I don't know if I didn't understand your answer, but you said that the Higgs mass is not an issue for you, right?
No, I didn't say that. Go on with the question. Yeah.
Well, you said at least that you can't get the Higgs mass exactly right now, right? It depends on the model or...
So, the Higgs mass... the Higgs mass is not predicted in this model because it depends on order one parameters, which in turn depends on many details of the composite spectrum you don't even know. And even if you knew, you would not be able to compute. So in this sense, the Higgs mass is not a prediction that can be directly falsified. Then you can ask yourself whether the size of the Higgs that you observe is reasonable or not. So how large or small we do estimate to find the Higgs mass, like in supersymmetry, right? In supersymmetry is not a prediction of the Higgs mass, but there are boundaries, and there is reasons of plausibility of this Higgs mass. Now, the general message is that due to the top contribution, and not to the gauge are fine, the top is a bit larger, due to the top contribution, in supersymmetry you would have liked to have the lightest Higgs, in spite of what people can tell you, but in supersymmetry they should have been lighter, not Marcus, but somebody else. In composite X, you would expect it to be a little bit heavier. Okay, so the top tends to give a too heavy contribution to the X mass in this sense. Can be accounted for, but it pushes down other particles, which can give constraints. So it's an issue. Okay, it leads to some issues.
Okay, so you put it like in supersymmetry, you don't have the right mass unless you make some fine tuning or something, or it's...
A way out would be to do some fine tuning. So the full story is like this. You can have the Higgs mass light if you, light compatible with data if you naturally, so without fine tuning, if you lower certain part of the spectrum by some factor. So let's say that the spectrum of the gauge resonance is at 3 TV, and the other guys that are called top partners are at 1.5 TV or 1 TV or so. But then you should find these particles, and you have to look at the other bounds. So somehow it's similar to the top-stop situation in supersymmetry.
Okay, thank you.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand how did you arrive to the vacuum expectation value. It's not
clear. I'm assuming that there is a potential, okay? There is a potential, and in this theory I wrote, there is actually a potential, which we could compute, you could not compute it in this particular theory. It would be quadratically divergent. But it comes from loops of the gauge fields, okay, that break the symmetry, and so can give a potential to the X. So there is this little potential, and it has a minimum. I call it V. Okay, I haven't said anything on the origin of this potential. Okay, I explained that how it could be there, but I haven't told you. Okay, I haven't told you how it depends on the X field, how it's formed, its estimate. I haven't told you this. Okay.
So just taking this Lagrangian and this Higgs vacuum expectation value comes only from loop effects,
yes,
or something.
No, the potential comes only for loop effect, which doesn't mean that the VEV is not loop suppressed. We wish it was so, but you see. Okay. There is a question? I think there is a question over there.
Sorry, if the symmetry breaking potential for capital H comes from loop effects, then why are we sure that it has the symmetry breaking form? Maybe it is...
Very good. Sure. So, that's also an interesting story. It comes out that the gauge contribution, so this depends on two things. This depends on the functional form of this potential as a function of the Goulson, of the Higgs. And this you can predict in terms of Goulson symmetry, okay? No, sine square in some cases, or sine cosine, I mean, it's fixed. And also depends on the sign, on the overall sign of this, whether the sign is positive or negative, you can have. Now, the gauge contribution gives a positive mass term. So only the gauge contribution, which I've written there, would not work. Will give a Higgs mass, but a positive one. Even though there are cases in which a gauge can give a negative. And this was actually an issue when Georgiou and Kaplan were building their models, because they were not finding out to achieve the negative VEB. They could do by adding extra stuff. There was an extra Z prime gauged elementary Z prime. There was extra material. Because instead the fermions give a negative contribution. Okay, the top in particular gives a negative mass contribution. But at the time, Georgiou and Kaplan could not know that the top was so heavy, and so that the Yukawa of the top was so large. So they thought the top Yukawa contribution is negligible. With the top Yukawa we have now, instead this contribution is actually a dominant one. So it's typically natural to have the right sign for the Higgs mass.
Taking literally this model, we have to add something extra to get symmetry breaking for potential for H.
So, first of all, you don't have to take literally this model, because you understand that this is a linear scalar theory, right? So this offers of hierarchy problem as
well. Just as a toy model.
No, don't take it. Don't take it. You see, this theory is very different from a composite sector. First of all, it offers itself an hierarchy problem, as I said. Second, it has only one resonance, which is a scalar resonance, while you have no reason to expect that. You will expect most actually vector resonances rather than scalar resonances. So I don't recommend you to take this model seriously. Anyhow, if you take it as it is, it also does not allow you to predict the Higgs mass, because the Higgs potential is quadratically divergent in this theory, in this simplified theory. So and then I can imagine it's completed because it's part of a more complicated sector, and then I can argue whether it's large or small, but this you cannot take as a representative model. Okay?
No more questions? Okay, let's thank Andrea again.